Our meticulously crafted Blender templates, tailored for novices and professionals alike, is your gateway to producing dynamic, high-quality clothing renders. A harmonious blend of ease and sophistication, these tools are designed to save you time and amplify your brand's visual style. Step into the future of apparel presentation and equip your brand with the edge it needs to stand out. The main file of this template uses Blender, so if you don't already have it, head over to blender.org to download and install it. You'll need at least version 3.5 or later for the mockup to work correctly. To add your design to the image file which applies to the garment, you can use Adobe Photoshop or a free online alternative called Photopea. Finally, if you want to render out animations and not just still images, you'll need compositing software. In this video, I'll show you how to composite your animation using DaVinci Resolve, a free software, as well as Adobe After Effects. Once you've downloaded the template, we're ready to get started. First, extract the zip file. Let's add our own designs to the file named design.psd. You can open it using either Photoshop or Photopea. First, I'm going to add my logo to the tags. I'll first drag and drop my logo on the canvas. Now I'm holding Shift and Option Alt on my keyboard, while dragging the corners to resize the image proportionally from the center. I'll place it in the center of the green safe areas of the tag guides and confirm the transform by clicking Confirm. With the logo still selected, I can hit Command J on Mac or Control J on Windows to duplicate it so that I can resize and replace accordingly on the other tags. I'll follow a similar process for adding designs to the rest of the garment. Note that this area shows where the hoodie pocket would be. The pocket is removable, but if you plan on showcasing a hoodie with a pocket, just make sure your designs are outside this area. Once you're ready, hide the guide layer, hit save, and open the Blender file. To see how your design looks on the garment, go to the Shading tab and make sure the garment object is selected with an orange outline so that the controls are visible in the shader editor. Nothing has changed yet, so we need to refresh the file by clicking this folder icon and selecting the design.psd. Make sure you are in either Material Preview or Render Preview mode. Material Preview is more responsive and quicker to navigate and preview your designs, while Render Preview will give a more accurate representation of how the final render will look. To navigate around your garment to check that the design is well placed, use this gizmo to rotate, the magnifier icon to zoom, and the hand icon to pan around. If the backdrop gets in the way, just hide it for now by unchecking this checkbox next to Scene. You can easily change the color of the fabric, labels, tassels, and stitching using these color pickers. The labels, tassels, and pocket are also removable by dragging these sliders down to zero. Don't worry about the dark spots left behind here. If we switch to the render preview, you can see that these won't show up in the final render. Switch back to the layout view so we can see the timeline. Here in the scene collection under clothing, we have all of the animated variations of the garment. By default, the template opens with a standard static version. Each variation is available for the hood up or down. To select a variation, just make sure the one you want is the only one checked. Most of these are quite self-explanatory in their titles. Variations with rotation 1 have a 360-degree rotation animation at a constant speed. Rotation 2 and 3 also rotate 360 degrees, but with different speed variations. Wind simulations feature subtle wind animation built into the fabric, and the walk cycle has a realistic walking animation built into it. You can speed up or slow down any animations in the template. The timeline in this project is 355 frames long at 30 frames per second, so around 11.8 seconds. To change the speed at which any animation happens, open up the collection and select the object. the keyframes now appear in the timeline which contain the animation. Click anywhere in the timeline to deselect the keyframes so they are no longer highlighted in orange. If you drag this last keyframe to the left, the animation will speed up. If there are multiple keyframes like in rotation 3, you can select all of them and proportionally scale them down by hitting S on the keyboard, moving the cursor inward and clicking to confirm it. As with the animation variations, just check the option you want to use. You can switch the background on to catch the shadows and act as a simple studio space, or you can leave it off to render with a transparent background. Switch to the render preview to get a better idea of how the lighting will look. If you want to change the color of the backdrop, select the studio backdrop object, go to its material properties, and change the base color. To have a plain solid background color instead, disable the scene, head over to the render properties, and uncheck the transparent setting under the film section. Then in world properties, change the color of the surface. To change the color of any light, open the collection and click on the light object. The object data properties for the light will automatically show up. Here you can change the color or brightness of the lights. Toggle these eye icons so you can see what effect each light has. The only light which has a different process for changing the color is the neon light. For this, switch to the shading tab and select any of these cylinder objects. Go to the material properties to bring up its related node tree. If you can't see anything, go to View Frame All. Adjust the emission color and the emission strength to adjust the brightness. There are over 70 camera presets, not including the variations that have depth of field built in, so I won't go through every single one. All you have to do to switch to a camera is click on the green camera icon next to a preset. If nothing happens in the viewport, make sure that the camera view is active. You can adjust the speed of camera animations the same way that we adjusted the animation speed of the garment. To get a smoother preview of the camera animation, you can switch back to the material preview. Go to the preferences found in the edit menu and on the system tab, check that in the cycles render devices, you have only the GPU device of your system checked. For other users, this could be under a tab labeled OpenGL instead of Metal like mine. If you don't have a dedicated GPU, just ignore this step and continue with your CPU. Go to the Render Properties tab and double check that you have GPU compute set for the device if you do have a dedicated graphics card. In the render settings, keep the max samples at 4096. In the latest versions of Blender, adaptive sampling is enabled by default. This means that Blender will automatically determine which parts of the image need the most time to render, so all you have to adjust is the noise threshold value. I've set it to 0.02 for this project. That value gives me a good quality image with minimal noise in a reasonable render time in most cases. But if you really need something done fast, you could increase this to 0.2 at most. If you have a decent graphics card or more patience, the lowest you should go is 0.002. The lower the value, the less noise, but the slower the render time. In summary, 0.2 for a fast render, 0.02 for a decent render, and 0.002 for the best render. Feel free to adjust between those values if you want to optimize your render further. Lastly, make sure denoise is unchecked. I wouldn't recommend using the built-in denoise because you could lose a lot of detail in the fabric texturing and possibly fine details in your design. This kind of denoising is also not great for animation and can leave strange artifacts behind. If you really must render at a high noise threshold, like 0.2, you should use a third-party temporal denoiser like this free Blender add-on. If you don't have a powerful machine or limited time, this is a great solution that I use myself and can highly recommend. You can adjust the resolution in the Output Properties tab, as well as the frame rate and length of the animation. For example, if I shorten this rotation animation to 109 frames, I'll change the end frame here to 109 so it only renders those frames. Once you are ready to render, choose an output location. If you have a transparent background, choose the PNG file format with RGBA color, Otherwise, if you are using the backdrop or a solid color, you can leave it on RGB. Finally, I'll make a still image render as a test before rendering the full animation. Select Render, Render Image. If you'd like, you can also save this here. Once you have done some test renders to adjust your noise threshold value, click Render, Render Animation. This will render out individual images of each frame that we need to stitch together in compositing software like DaVinci Resolve or Adobe After Effects. One good reason why this is a good idea, among various other reasons, is because if you render out an MP4 from Blender, if the software crashes, you will lose all your progress. But if we render individual frames, we can just carry on from the last completed frame rendered. To composite in DaVinci Resolve, open it up and start a new project. Match the frame rate to the frame rate used in your Blender project by going to File, Project Settings, and change the timeline frame rate, then save. Next, change the layout at the bottom to Media, and navigate to where your animation frames are saved. To create a shortcut to a folder where you can easily access your renders, right-click and add a new location. Once you're in the folder with your frames, click these three dots and change the frame display mode to Sequence, and drag this file into the media pool. Switch over to the edit view and drag this clip into the timeline. Then switch to deliver view to adjust the final export settings. Choose a location for your final video and stick with the default settings for a standard MP4. If you want to export with a transparent background, in the case where you might be compiling this into an existing video project with your own custom backgrounds, then choose GoPro Cineform RGB 16-bit. Add to render queue and render all. Your final video is now ready. To composite in Adobe After Effects, double-click in the project pane to bring up the import window. Select the first image in your animation sequence and check the Create Composition and PNG Sequence options, then hit Open. Right-click on the sequence and go to Interpret Footage Main, and make sure the frame rate matches what you have in your Blender project. Go to File, Export, Add to Render Queue, and adjust the final export settings. For a standard MP4 file, stick with this H.264 preset in the output module, and choose a location for your final video. If you have a transparent background, choose the Lossless with Alpha preset in the output module. Click Render and your final video is now ready. You can leave a comment on the video if you have any questions not covered, and I'll do my best to respond as soon as I can. I'm also available through the contact form on my website or directly via email if you need any additional assistance.